Now, on this site, this is what we call a permanent forest opening. So this particular landowner had a conservation contract with the NRCS to allow him to come in, and we picked four or five places throughout his property that had really poor quality timber or no timber, but they were still a good site that was not highly erodible. So we did four or five of these out here, and these were sites that had a little bit of cedar, they had some invasives, they had a little bit of soft maple, and a lot of multiflora rose. So what we did is we just brought a dozer operator in here, and he cleared this area and just shoved the brush down into a draw and buried it. And then we came in, or I came in and took soil samples, and we amended the soil based on the pH and the fertilizer requirements. And then I just broadcasted a really good blend of chicory and annuals and perennial clovers. And our objective on this is going to be a permanent opening. We're not going to allow this to grow back into hardwoods, but the reason we like these are we're right in the middle of a 700 acre property, and now we've got five or six of these throughout the property. So now we've got a good permanent forest opening. We've got a really nice area for turkeys to bring their chicks into to graze or browse for the insects that are on the clover that we planted. It's a really good area that's concealed for deer to come and feed. From a hunting standpoint, these permanent forest openings are excellent food plot areas or areas where we can come in and hunt and maybe get a good shot at a trophy whitetail. So the difference between a forest opening and a permanent forest opening is in our forest openings, we're making a regeneration harvest from the hardwoods, removing the mature timber, coming in and doing post-harvest timber stand improvement, but we want the native hardwoods to grow back. That still provides a lot of cover for our wildlife, but we're allowing the native hardwoods to come back for our timber investment. On a permanent forest opening, we're going to keep this area an open area by either mowing it and maintaining it, making sure that we always have some kind of an annual or perennial crop growing in these areas. Now, on these small openings, I don't do a lot of soybeans. I don't do a lot of annual crops. They're just too small because it's an isolated pocket back in the middle of a heavy forested area. If you tried to plant soybeans back in here, the deer would eat them to the ground before they ever grew. So the best idea or the best option we have in these areas are to come in and do like a clover chicory or maybe a clover alfalfa blend. Now, if the opening is large enough, maybe it's a half acre or 3 acres in size, you can come in and do an annual clover in the spring and then maybe do a fall food plot of wheat, oats, peas, and turnips in the fall, and then you basically can rotate that every year. And there's not a thing wrong with that. Matter of fact, on one of these sites, about a half mile farther back, it's about a half acre in size. We just sowed it into an annual clover with some wheat and some oats. We're going to let the wheat and oats mature. The turkeys will love that this summer. And then this fall, we'll go right back in there and put down a good blend of wheat, oats, peas, and turnips to get the deer through the winter. And then next spring, we'll come back in and do the annual clover on it again. So these are just really good foraging areas, again, for deer, for turkeys, and for your migratory songbirds to come in and feed and forage. So the seed source we used in here, and because, believe it or not, up in these hills of southern Indiana, this is a very sandy site. So I went heavy on the clover, but I also mixed in some chicory and alfalfa because the chicory and alfalfa have a longer taproot and they survive really well on sandy sites. I never go heavy on the alfalfa simply because the alfalfa is going to die off sooner in the fall than say the clover will, but the chicory, you know, it's just going to stay, and it's going to be a really good source for the deer as well. The other thing I like to do on these openings is my paint marks will only go out to where the really good hardwoods start. So for example, on the back side of us over here, we have several mature white oak and black oak trees. So right at the edge of this forest opening where you have all this forage, we also have really good acorn production, which makes this an absolute fabulous bow hunting site. Also, sometimes in these openings, if they're large enough, you can leave one or two oak trees right in the middle of it. That black oak tree is not going to provide enough shade to hurt the germination of my clover, but it's going to provide a lot of acorns for deer and turkeys. So that's just another asset to that. So keep that in mind when you're thinking about these permanent forest openings. Go out as far as you want to, but as soon as you hit that next really good food source, such as a mast producing tree like a white oak or a black oak, quit right there, make the opening so you have your acorn production, your acorns falling into your opening, as well as the opening that's here with the forage. Now, the other thing I like to do is along these edges, I like to leave some of the cedar trees because those are just great places to hang a tree stand where you can sit and a deer will find it very hard to see you there. So you'll notice on some of these openings, there are a few cedars here and there. Those were left intentionally for spots to hang a tree stand. So just certain things to keep in mind when you're thinking about these permanent forest openings.